out of college.
Uh-huh.
And I finished my third year.
Forget not all of his benefits. And when we think of all of his benefits, there are just so many things in that particular scripture. It says that the Lord heals, the Lord forgives, he provides mercy. There are so many different things that the Lord does. And some of the things that God has done have just been absolutely spectacular. One of my students, Henos, for 2 years he was in Bible school, he was blind. Time and time again he came to be prayed for. He wanted to be healed of his blindness. You know, really within our own hearts, we, I guess we'd become a little bit
jaded,
disbelieving,
or, yeah.
Would perhaps be the term to use.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a little bit sad that this man would keep coming up the front to be prayed for. And one day he said to me, "When am I going to be healed?" Now he didn't ask in agitation, but in expectation. When am I going to be healed? Now, his question challenged me, and I said to him, Henos, the Lord has his perfect time for everything. Now, what happened with Henos is that he'd been blind from his youth. He became a Christian. He had studied the scriptures. People read the Bible. He had a tremendous capacity to memorize scripture. He came into Bible school. He studied the scriptures. He believed the scriptures. He went back to his village, he became an assistant to the pastor, and evangelists would come through and have healing campaigns, and he would always be the first one up to the front. Now, I probably prayed for him some 15 times. Now I know what was happening in his life. Instead of what Henos was doing being a confrontation to our unbelief, what he was actually doing was filling the bowl of grace. The Bible says in Psalm 23, my cup runneth over. But before the cup runneth over and the grace of God begins to flow, the cup needs to be filled. And sometimes there are people who are praying and praying and praying, and it's as though God's not answering their prayers. But he is, because what's happening is every time we pray, we are filling the bowl. And in Henos's case, for 20 years he prayed and he prayed and he prayed. He got married, he had a son, didn't know what they looked like, of course. But then one morning, he'd been asked to take over the church for a while because the pastor had passed away. And he was mocked, the blind leading the blind, they said. But this one morning, he was up at 4:30, as he always was, to pray. And as he was praying, fire began to burn in his eyes. And after prayer, he opened up his eyes and he was healed. Now, he didn't want to say anything, so he went out and sat on the porch outside because he was as shocked as anybody by his healing, even though he was praying for it. But all of a sudden, the bowl of God's grace was full,
right,
and it was now poured out on his life. And so he heard his son playing out in the ground. He fell over and he began to cry. Now his father's heart couldn't withstand anymore, so he stood up, he walked over to where his son was, picked him up, brought him back and sat down. His wife saw him do this, and she knew that Henos, who was blind, now just to give you an idea, this happened 5 years ago, near the city of Tomini, on the island of Sulawesi and in the province of central Sulawesi. I know him personally, his name is Henos Babau, and he's a worker in the Gereja Pentecosta di Indonesia. So it's a real person, a real place, you know, and I've known this person myself. And his wife came running out from the kitchen, and she said, "Henos, Henos," because she knew that he couldn't see, he couldn't do what he had just done. And so she came out saying, "Henos, Henos, can you see? Can you see?" And so that's how his healing was announced. And blind people came from everywhere. The Muslims, the Buddhists, the Hindus, the Catholics, the Protestants, anybody who was blind came to the village, and they wanted to find out what was the secret of being healed. And so Henos would say to them, "Repent, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and pray for 20 years, and you will be healed." That was his experience. See, now other people don't have to pray that long for that miracle to happen in their lives. But with Henos...
They typed Uncle Jesse, and he had B negative blood.
He says that God still speaks to people today, and he obeyed that impulse and went to the hospital rather than going home and shaving and showering, waiting for visiting hours. And the nurse on duty said if he had not shown up when he did, it would have been curtains long before, because they needed the B-negative blood. That was wonderful. I have to tell you that right after that, there was everything that could go wrong went wrong, the emergencies that kept coming. But there always seemed to be a nurse or a nurse's aide that would show up at the right time. I am amazed at the loving care that I received, and especially in Florida, 700 miles away from home, people that touched me and let me know that they cared whether I lived or whether I died. I believe that doctors and nurses have a double opportunity to heal people through their loving attitude and through their learning experiences. I had pneumonia, and water filled my lungs, and they took a 4-inch needle, would go in and pull the liquids out. It was really rough. At the end of this 44-day period of struggle, all of my veins collapsed, and they could not give me any more intravenous feedings, no more blood transfusions. So they talked to my family and put a no-visitor sign on the door and told them to go home and get some rest and promised that when the end came, they would call them. Though the no-visitor sign was on the door, I had a visitor. I began to struggle, couldn't get my breath, and I prayed. Now, you can't pray out loud, but I prayed silently, "Oh, God, send a doctor." I heard a man's footsteps, and I thought, "Oh, that's wonderful. He got there so quick." All of a sudden, I heard the pages of a Bible being turned, and I thought, "I don't need a preacher. I need a doctor. I found Jesus as my Savior when I was 13. I know about these things. All I need now is a doctor." It was not a doctor, it was art. This was a man that went to our church, and he was a self-appointed preacher, one of those homemade jobs. I never liked him. And he came, and I thought, just like him, he's going to preach at me. He began to turn the pages of the Bible. But let me tell you how wise the Holy Spirit was in prompting him. He read a scripture, Psalm 107, verse 20. He sent his word and healed them. Now, I had had a lot of people pray for me and nothing happened. I got worse. But I believe that God, in his overruling practical providence, waited until no person could take credit for a miracle and the word would receive glory for what was about to happen. For when Art read, "He sent his word and healed them," faith began to well up in my heart that maybe I would make it after all. And when he left the room, I did something that I rarely do. I cried, and I promised God, "I will never, ever again judge a person by their outward appearance. I will never penalize a person for a lack of education, nor because of one, if you will give me a second chance to live again." And I had such love in my heart for this man that I had never liked before. It's strange when you face death how important simple things are. And I asked the Lord, I beg for a second chance. Shortly after he left the room, it was all over. But I want to describe death to you the way it, in my own words. I was totally surprised. It was like getting on a roller coaster at Disney. And when you peak that high point of the ride, it was a thrill. It was very exciting. And I was launched from this planet to another one. And it was a country as real as England or America. There is life after death, and it is not a place where spirits float around, bored, being nice. It is a real place. I walked through a meadow, and beside me was a tall, tall angel. We could communicate with our voices if we wanted to, but mostly we talked with our think. Suddenly people began to run toward me that I knew that had died. They knew me and I knew them. I saw my baby brother and he was very excited to see me. Then we went through this meadow and started up a hill. As we walked up this hill, I heard music like I have never heard before in all of my life here. I stopped and then I joined the singing. I've always dreamed of singing in high, sweet tones. I was born with a girl's body, but with a deep voice. But while I was there, I sang like I've always wanted to sing. I believe that there you will become what you've always wanted to be here, but never quite made it. And I also saw people doing the same thing there that they did here, only in a perfect environment. Now, this group of people will have to get a different job because there was no sickness and there was no pain up there. This amazed me, the singing. And when the music stopped, I heard the voice of Jack Holcomb, a Swedish tenor. I'd heard him in concert in Dallas, Texas, and I had some of his records. I heard him sing two songs, "I Have Been Born Again," and "The Old Account Was Settled Long Ago." I thought, this is strange. How could I hear him way up here where I am? And I want to stop and tell you that after this experience, when I started writing the book, I called Waco, Texas to ask him how I heard him sing up there. And I got a woman on the phone that told me she was Jack's widow. She said, I knew he would be singing there. So this was an amazing experience. After hearing him sing, I wanted to go in. We were walking along a wall, a most beautiful, majestic wall. Now, I worked at Edwards Jewelry Store, and I did not really understand the book of Revelation, so this was amazing to me. The walls of that city had 12 layers of precious stones, and the ninth layer of stone was the golden topaz, my November birthstone. I didn't know that. Later, after this experience, I read it in chapter 21 of the book of Revelation. And heaven is built according to the architectural specifications laid out in the Bible. I was amazed when I read it later. As we walked along, I then wanted to go inside this capital city of this glorious country where I had arrived. And the angel knew that, and he touched the gate. When I walked inside, a brilliant yellow light went through my cold body, and I stood tall and erect. There was no more pain. And the light was coming from the face of Jesus at the right of the Father in an awesome golden throne room. And when I looked, the face and the brilliance of the light was too bright, and I looked down and it reflected on a golden boulevard down the center of the city, and it shined through me. And then I ran to the right of me, for I saw what looked like northern lights. These were like laser beams ascending from the earth, and they were ascending to that throne room, that awesome golden throne room, which was the source of all light and creativity and power that causes this earth to be energized and to be warmed. And these were prayers. And on one shaft of light, I saw my Father's voice registered. I was not aware of what was happening on the earth. They had called my family, and my Father stepped to my bed. They had covered me with a sheet, and he was so disappointed. All he could say was, "Jesus," to comfort himself. But he said, in that moan was a wish that you had not died. I never wanted to leave. But these laser lights were prayers ascending from the hearts of people on the earth, arriving in the throne room. And God answered my Father's one-word prayer. In an emergency, when there is no time for an intelligent prayer, or when your heart is so broken you cannot think straight. His name will always be enough. When you speak the name of Jesus, you have an immediate audience with the Almighty, the Father. And my mind was changed, and I travel faster than a jet plane back toward the hospital. I look through the roof of the hospital, through the fifth floor, through the fourth floor, into room 336. And as this happened, I felt like I was on an elevator, and when it hit the bottom floor, I slid back into my shell. And as I did, the morning sun was coming through the glass across my bed, and in that morning ray were ivory letters pulsating, and I squinted to try to read them, and I recalled what Art read to me. He sent his word and healed them. And when I squinted to read these ivory letters, it was St. John 11:25. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Now, I had had a lot of hallucinations from drugs, from lack of oxygen, and from pain. And I thought, could this be hallucination? So I reached up and I touched the word, and life went into my fingers. And I recalled what Art said. He sent his word and healed them. And life went into my arms and into my body. And I sat up, pushed the sheet off my face, and scared a whole room full of people. Nobody talked. They all just leaned against the wall for a little while. And I looked out, and the most beautiful thing I saw was grass, the morning sun and the grass. And I saw a boy carrying a case of 7-Up on his shoulders into the vending machine for the hospital. I never liked people before. I loved that man so much, I would have jumped out the window and hugged him if I could have. Love for people. I came back with a love for people that was probably a greater miracle than the medical impossibility that had happened to me.
So tell us a story of your most recent adventures.
Okay.
Who the heck are you?
My name is Michelle. And
where are we?
We are in Hickson, Tennessee. And actually receiving a miracle today with our furniture. But let me tell you about what the Lord has done for me. I was diagnosed with cancer late last month, and it was a tumor in my lung. And they said it was the size of a golf ball. It was very aggressive, and I was very scared.
Somebody had said pancreas.
No.
That was totally
my lung,
off.
My lung.
Okay.
It scared me a lot. It's, you know, I've got lupus, but that didn't scare me half as much as cancer. The word cancer is very, very scary. And
let that stew for a while, because I know when I lay my seeds, it stews for a long time.
Yes. Okay, well, then let Brian handle it, because he can easily.
Well, he's handling it, but not in the way that.
Not in the mommy way.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, that was really good. That was the master of the universe. Throwing. So just say, that was the guy.
That was the guy who got
me. How did you meet him?
Actually, through the game shop. You know, he does the gaming thing with his Champions game. And Brian does the D20 and the Champions game also down at the game. And they met at the game shop. And through that, you know, and he knew him, and he said, that's who I want to marry us. And Brian did. Mm. And I met Jeff, and he was like, okay, but we have to do counseling and this and that. And that's how that came into be. And, it once we got into the religious part of it, he started talking to me. You know, God started talking to me a little bit, like, this is what we need. You need to be there. You need to do this. This is what needs to be done for us to get our work done. And I'm sitting there going, whoa, look, who's talking to me? Honestly, I mean, because it was like, because I've never been one for hearing God at all. And I woke up out of my sleep, and it was like, we need to talk to Jeff today. And so got, you know, Jeff came over last Monday and they helped us clean some, him and Bonnie, come and, you know, helped us get started with our cleaning and making it our house. And
okay, now put that in real terms. These people who you barely know,
right,
came over to your house and they did what with you?
They helped me spring clean our house because it was a mess. You know, and it just something that, you know, I couldn't hardly believe that these people that didn't even know me hardly from anybody, they'd met me three times in their life, were willing to drop everything and bring their kids and help us. You know, it was something that is so monster. I mean, it was monstrously big.
It was freaking you out.
Yeah, and I was like, you know, and it was the day I'd had my chemo. It was the day I'd had my chemo. So they were like,
what?
You sit back and let us do this. Let us bless you. You sit back.
Uh-huh.
And they made me go sit in my room. and Brian and them did the house. And
what were you picturing going on? The chemo like? I mean, tell me a little bit about the doctor stuff and
okay.
Come on.
The chemo was rough. They were actually putting the injection straight into the tumor itself, which is very painful. Very painful. I was probably looking at another 3 rounds of chemo. It just did not happen.
You can hold the kitty.
Kimberly, she's wanting to explore. I was probably looking at about another 3 rounds of chemo and maybe even a round of radiation. And losing the rest of my hair that didn't come out already. And, which my hair was my life. I had long hair.
Wow.
And it started falling out. And I decided to cut it all off because it would be easier to lose a little bit than my whole head. And so I took the rest of it and sent it to Locks of Love, my hair that was left. And it was rough to part with it, but I honestly think that God put me through this so that I could get back to Him. And this so that I could get back to Him. And I mean, I know God didn't do this to me, but it had to happen for a reason. And I think that was the reason. So that God could show me that He is really, awesomely real.
And now you're called to a high responsibility.
Yes, I am.
And that's the cool part.
Yes, it is.
It gives you chill bumps.
Yes, it is.
Because you know you've been commanded to step into a role that almost nobody gets to step into.
That's right. And that's why I feel so strongly about sharing my experience with everybody, because I know that God did this for me and He gave me a gift that not a whole lot of people get. That I know my God is real now, and He's not just on a piece of paper or in a book, but He is there.
And gives kisses and hugs,
right,
and tickles and whispers.
That's right.
And shouts on the inside.
Yes. Like I told you, I mean, I was like, you know, when He started talking to me, it was like, who is that? You know? I mean, it was awesome. And He just really has commanded me to do His work. And I really think that this is what this all happened.
Okay, now talk about that prank. Proper introduction. This is like my posse, my old friends, you know, this is kind of like, hi everybody, something wild happened to these people and it's so cool that they're part of my life. And what's that kid's name?
This is Jacob.
What's your name?
Hey, Jacob.
Jacob.
And what's that big man's name? What's that man's name? Who's that? Who that man?
Brian.
Brian, all right. Okay. Very good.
The doctor is like totally blown away. He is, Dr. Edon told me that, he told me he couldn't explain it, and I told him I could. God took it. And, he just kind of looked at me, And he said, well, I had something to do with it. I said, yes, God directed your hands to give me the chemo and everything. I said, but the rest of it, he did himself. Because he told me it was like a tumor. It was like somebody went in surgically and removed it without the scar. He said, there's no trace at all. And he said that, he said he couldn't explain it. I said, I could, that God removed it. And he said, well, you're the first one to tell me that.
Really?
And he said that now I've had faith-based people tell me that God, you know, was there with them and this and that, but you're the first one to tell me he ever removed it. And he just walked out of the room scratching his head. He didn't really know what to say to that. And my other doctor, who was actually the one who found that the tumor was gone, he did ultrasound, and he's the one that realized that it was gone to begin with. He told me that he believed it, and that because he found it on Sunday. He did the ultrasound. He came into the office on a Sunday to give me a shot of Neulasta. He asked me if we could do a quick ultrasound. And he's the one, and he said, I can't find it. And I said, what do you mean you can't find it? You know, I was right here. And he's like, no, it's not there. And he said, well, I guess I should have gone to church this Sunday, you know, today. And I said, no, because God needed you here with me. And,
Yeah, the church is people, and we are it.
That's right. And I told him, he said, well, I guess I'll be going to church every Sunday from now on because you won't need me because God's taking care of you.
So that's the person who first told
me that
you?
The tumor was gone. It was on Sunday.
Uh-huh.
And it absolutely blew me away. And he said, we're going to make sure we're going to do an MRI tomorrow.
And it was on Sunday what day?
This last Sunday.
Sunday
the 10th. Ninth.
Is that
right? No.
Okay. It was
from today.
Sunday the 14th.
The 14th.
I mean the 15th.
The 15th.
The 15th, because the 13th is when we did the prayer.
And we were praying the prayers on Friday the 13th.
13th.
Yeah! Come on!
How's that for
you? You want to see a Friday the 13th Halloween movie? Forget that.
We got your miracle right.
Friday the 13th. Full tilt supernatural whammy healing movie. This is it right here.
Right.
You're seeing it
right
here, folks. That's you. You're seeing the Friday the 13th movie of a different sort.
That's right.
Oh, wow. I never.
You know, the Lord just kind of put it on you guys to really pray for us and, you know, and heal us.
And talk to the people that are watching.
I'm sorry.
These people.
Okay. These people.
So you're over at that guy Jeff's house.
Yes, we're at Jeff's house. And David.
And the other David. Hi.
David. we're there. And
David, who's been a buddy of Jeff's for 9 years or so, and they've been working together, and they've got their issues, and
they're
chatting and going through stuff.
Yeah. And so we got to talking about the cancer with David. With Dave, and he decided that we needed to be prayed for, and
that's Dave, the furniture mover.
The furniture mover, that's right. And so Dave anointed us with oil and prayed for us, and then David gave us the blessing of as man and woman, and I felt a healing, but not really a healing, a spiritual blessing.
You got a whammy. I mean, I was watching you get slammed.
Yes.
I mean, I haven't seen one like that. I mean, when, like, all of a sudden, at 1 second, like, when that scripture popped up, and I was blown away by that scripture, and then, like, all of a sudden, it looked over at you. At one moment, you were just there. The next moment, you were like crying and laughing and shaking
yes,
your
yes,
head.
Yes, God was definitely started working with me while he was talking, and it was like all of a sudden I didn't feel nauseous, I stayed nauseous with the chemo.
Wow.
I didn't feel nauseous. I didn't feel weak. It was just, I was fine. I was standing there. And
right then,
Right then.
It was just like
everything that was wrong at that moment was gone. Honestly, it was just like somebody had taken all of my ills at that moment. And I really didn't know what to make of it at the moment. And then all of a sudden, he said, "I am with you." And
while you were there?
While I was there.
Oh, cool.
And I wasn't scared. I didn't get scared. Of course, the first time he talked to me, I was scared. But I knew I was at peace, you know? And there was something about it that just made perfect sense that he was standing there with me. And, of course, I didn't know it that day. I mean, I knew that, you know, I didn't feel the sickness. But, of course, I didn't know that day that I was healed.
Right.
It waited until Sunday. That was Friday.
And then, okay, now, the Lord's told me to wrap up right now, and I don't know why that is.
It is. There had been some miracles at the church. There had been a woman that was brought down, that was sick, that they wanted prayer for, and she died. And the kids at the orphanage there were praying for her, and around midnight, the kids all got baptized in the Spirit. And then they really started to pray, and towards morning the woman came back to life again. And those kids were on fire for the Lord.
How old were the kids? What kind of kids are you talking about?
They were mostly they might have been up through junior high school.
Uh-huh.
Mostly elementary school kids.
Uh-huh.
And they wanted to do something, and we said, "Well, we'll give you some training," but we had to go someplace for a few weeks, we hoped that these kids would still be there for us to train when we got back. Well, we came back, and we didn't have to train them. They had been running all over this whole mountain area, and everywhere they went, miracles were happening, and people were getting converted, So we were just kind of a little team of people for probably 5 years. We were praying to get a training center started. We at one time thought we needed a classroom and had one set up, but we never used it. And the Lord sent us places and started doing things. And so we got involved in all kinds of ministry all over the country. I mean, we went to other islands and sometimes the Lord just told us to go to a certain island, and we went there. But all of these things always began with an awful lot of prayer. And it just seemed, at least the only thing that I've ever seen that really works in ministry is just to start, get a group of people together and start to pray and worship in the Spirit. And so that's really what Harry and those guys you saw were trying to do down there in Virginia. And we imported Indonesians because they...
Harry? Which is?
Harry is my son, the little guy that... he had a tan jacket on earlier.
Yeah, okay.
He's kind of low key. You don't notice him very much, but
yeah, uh-huh.
That's his style of leadership. And so he's imported these guys to help him pray for the work. It just started in July down there in Virginia. And they mostly been praying, but then they, like the Indonesians, can get up at 5 a.m. and start praying and keep on doing that until stuff happens.
Yeah, I like that.
Most Americans can't really do that. And
early morning prayer and morning Eucharist is like nothing, nothing else. Manna in the morning.
Yes.
That's, hello.
You and I know that, but most Americans don't.
Well, see, I know questions and resistance points is actually outlined in Tongues of Fire. What experiences have you had with people actually being able to speak in languages understandable by others that they weren't capable of?
I can give you some examples of that. We were in Manado, North Sulawesi. We were at the Bible school in Airamadidi. And when we were having this conference, that there had been two factions of the church that had been split. And there had been fighting even with machete knives, and churches had been burned down. And this was a conference that we called to bring the pastors together in this particular denomination. And so pastors and wives and elders came, and about 3,000 people were there. And as we were ministering, a young girl, about a 12-year-old girl, began to prophesy in perfect English. Now, she was in the front row, and it caused quite a commotion. People began to run around and take photographs of her. She's a 12-year-old girl doing something that seemed to be, you know, quite unusual. And she was prophesying in English. But because of the commotion, people up the back would not have been able to have heard her. And there was a man immediately after this, in Indonesian, gave exactly the same message in Indonesian. Now, I speak fluent Indonesian. Karena saya lancar berbahasa Indonesia, saya bisa berbahasa Indonesia sepanjang hari. I could speak Indonesian all day, no problems. And so I went down to this young girl and I spoke to her in English. And I said to her, I said, what's your name? And she looked at me. And I said to her again, I said, what's your name? How old are you? And she turned around and she looked at her father and she said to her father, apa dia bilang? What did he say? Now, in Indonesian. And so I talked to her father, and I said to her father, how long has your daughter been studying English? And he said, oh, we come from a village. We don't know any English. What do you mean? Now, this girl had given a fluent prophecy in English, a language that she did not know. And so what had happened was that the Holy Spirit had come upon her, and she had spoken in fluent English in a prophecy, which was actually to her, was speaking in tongues, or another language that she had never learned. And there was a man up the back who had the gift of interpretation of tongues, who had given the interpretation, and he too didn't know any English, but had given an exact interpretation. So it was an example of the power of God. Now, another incident happened when...
Do you remember what the prophecy was, or do you remember the...
It was a message confirming what we had been declaring. We had been declaring a message on the restoration of Zion. We'd been talking about the unity of the body of Christ. And the prophetic message, in essence, because this is now some 18 years ago that this particular event happened, was, these are my servants that I have sent into your midst. They are bringing my word. The word that they are bringing to you is the word that will heal you. Therefore, hear the word that they have been declaring unto you. You know, so that was basically the gist of what the message that was proclaimed. Now, another example, a friend of mine, his name is Richard Holland. He founded the largest full gospel charismatic church in Melbourne, Australia, called Waverley Christian Fellowship. So, and they have about 3,000 in their congregation. Now, his father had an amazing experience. In 1912, he was one of the first three men to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit in Melbourne, Australia. And he had heard that another man had received the baptism of the Spirit, but he didn't know what his name was, didn't know where he lived, didn't know what he looked like, and he had said, Lord, I want to meet this man. I too want to experience this. And the Lord said to him, get on a train. He got on a train and got to a station. The Lord said, get off. He got off. He walked up and down the streets, and the Lord said, go into this street. He went down this street. The Lord said, go into this house. He got up to this house, and he knocked on the door, and a man opened the door, and he said to him, are you the man that has the Holy Ghost? And the man said, come on in. And then he got prayed for, and he got filled with the Holy Spirit, because the Lord had led him to this place. Now, this man, Richard Holland, went to Indonesia, and he was praying for people in a healing line, but there were so many people there, and there was so much that was happening. He said to his interpreter, look, you go over there and pray for these people, and I'll just pray in tongues for these people here. And he began praying for them, speaking in tongues, as he prayed for these people, because he thought he might as well pray in tongues because they didn't understand English. But afterwards, many of the people were telling their pastor, how come that you were interpreting for him when he was preaching? Because this man speaks fluent Indonesian. Because what had happened is when he was praying for them, he was praying over them in fluent Indonesian. I've also got know of other people that have had similar experiences. So it's not a totally uncommon thing. It doesn't happen every day, it doesn't happen every month, maybe not even every year. But 1 Corinthians 13 certainly speaks about there being tongues of men and of angels. And in the New Testament, we only have one example of where the people heard the tongues and directly understood it. And that was in Acts chapter 2. In all other incidents in the New Testament, they had to have the gift of interpretation to interpret and give understanding to the message that was given. So if it only happened once in the New Testament where there was a direct gift of where people immediately understood as they heard it, and all of the other incidences had to be interpreted, then I think that that's what we would expect to happen today, that from time to time there would be a miraculous event where people would understand what was being proclaimed. But the normal thing is that God would also have people there that have a gift of interpretation who would then be able to give that interpretation.
And also Paul makes the comment about the reference to those speaking in tongues as being babbler. So there's an indication that everyone is not understanding what is being spoken. That's
why he said, if you in the church, I would rather speak 5 words with my understanding than 10,000 words with a language that nobody understands. And yet he said, I speak in tongues more than you all. Now, if he spoke in tongues more than all of the Corinthians, that meant he did a lot of praying in tongues, but he would have done that in his own prayer life because it was building up his own faith. It was to encourage him. It was his personal, the Spirit of God within him, crying out before God in intercession, strengthening his faith, praying for the church, praying for things that he didn't know what their needs were. He probably needed to pray for somebody, but he didn't know what their specific needs, and he would pray in the Spirit for them. But in the church, he would speak in a language that people would understand. And he said, if somebody speaks in an unknown tongue, let it be 2 or at the most 3, and let there be an interpreter who will interpret. And if there be no interpreter, let him keep silent, for he speaks to himself and to God. So the teaching of the Apostle Paul is that the normal experience is not that people will directly understand the spoken tongue's message, but that it should be interpreted.
We latch on to things as we read. I'm beginning to realize how we should always pray, which I'm getting better at. And we should read Scripture. Scripture. You know what? That first week, while I was still drinking, I was reading the Scripture, though, too.
Right.
And I burst into tears when I saw that part where Christ said, build up things in God, where neither moth nor rust can corrupt. For where your heart treasure is, there will your heart be also. That was so loaded. That what Christ said out of his mouth was so loaded with imagery to me. In other words, if you treasure alcohol, drug, womanizer, football.
Excellent.
if you treasure any of that,
I know. I knew it was here, and I knew it would just show up to me just like that. I didn't even know where to start looking.
At first, I thought of it as him appealing to me in my heart because I'm a mush case when it comes to loving the heart thing. But it was a whole lot more than that. It was like worlds more than that. because it was an admonishment. I'm starting to realize it was an admonishment that you're going to, if you treasure something, your heart's going to be in it. But if you don't
take the leap
really
of faith,
what he meant was, yeah. But trust in me.
Yeah, trust.
I'm the way, the truth, and the life.
Take the jump.
God,
yeah.
Treasure that.
Right.
And I'll show you God.
Awesome.
If you treasure anything in destruction, there's where your heart will be, and there's where you will end up.
Yeah. And the strange thing is, you can be. It comes through you because you just give up. I mean, you completely say, okay, I'm dead. You take over.
That's exactly what happened to me.
Right.
That's exactly what happened.
Yeah, I remember
well,
the feeling too.
Because I was dead. I was dead all around.
There's no bottom to it. Well, most of the things, the same thing with that organized club. after all the extra curricular activities and concessions are all gone, there's nothing else again. This is, well, where do you go to get something where there's always something left?
Yes.
Okay, and of course, with God and Jesus aspect, there's always something left. It's not enough. It's like, more. It's always, well, some more.
Getting wisdom.
Like,
again, your eyes get open.
You're out in the desert, and he sends you locusts and honey, and it's fun.
The club. Right. The club is over, you know?
Like, you're kidding. That can't be good.
The president do something wrong, and the club is over. They stop supporting your deal, or they, you know, you don't get the attention that you need. It's over with. It's like, that's the end of the club. And of course, as I was saying earlier, the other things, like, you know, the happy hour's over, that's over. Now the television show is on. Now what? I'll look at the next television show. It's like, I need to use the time. It's like, well, on the God issue, it's a lot of time to spend. I mean, say, is there any more? I say, yes. Mm-hmm. Just watch. Now you're done with that. Now let's get into some history. Is it done with that? Yeah, now let's get into some powers. Is it now? Let's get into, you go into science?
I mean, it makes quantum physics boring. Yeah. You know?
You got infidel scientists.
It makes black holes, like, kind of like not so. That's so fascinating.
My favorite scientists nowadays, even to the point before Carl Sagan died, they were looking into the Bible for some answers they couldn't find out.
I exalt thee. God can't teach me all by myself. So
I spent about an hour and a half reading this verse and this verse.
What's a concordance?
A concordance is like a dictionary in a way, and it's like an index in a way. It has, for example, if you want to say awake, and you remember there's a, or hallelujah, that's a good one. Where is hallelujah found in the Bible? So you look under the H's in a concordance, and it'll give you probably 40 places that hallelujah is listed, with just a little zerp of the sentence. Well, the same way went with Holy Spirit. So I went through as many as I could, and finally I thought, this is a good thing. This is what I want from God. I want the Holy Spirit really big. So I said that to God, simply, just like that girl that lay down and said, Jesus, keep me warm. I just said, God, I want the Holy Spirit really now and big time. I didn't know what I said. It was so long ago. But I said something to that effect. People call that dissociation in psych language, but you can't remember at a traumatic time what you said, but you did. You knew you said something, but you can't quote even yourself. This happened.
But then when you get into the Holy Spirit, you can say, Lord, what did I say? And he'll bring it right back to you.
And the more, anyway, when this happened, all of a sudden, into my mouth, came these words that, out of my mouth, I went talking and talking and joyfully talking for a good hour. In fact, I was sitting in the living room, something like this, on the floor with Bibles and concordances and things around me. I thought, there's something weird going on with me. I want to see what it is. So I went into the bathroom to see my mouth moving. I did. I went in there and I thought, yeah, this is me. I'm doing this. God is doing this. You know, I was so excited. I haven't told him this part of it. He's laughing because he didn't know about that part.
Baptized in fire?
It was no fire. It was mouthing of tongues. Glossolalia came to me. And I felt so uplifted. I didn't feel a warmth. I just felt just wonderful. I just felt so joyful. Very, very joyful. For a whole hour or so. Then I calmed down and I got on the phone to tell my teacher, who was a Baptist missionary to Haiti, my age. She had two little kids, the same ages as mine, and a wonderful husband, and she had been teaching this book of Acts. She said, we're only going to keep you one hour, and I have an assignment of learning a Bible verse per week. When you come back, please try to repeat it. Just go over this verse, and she gave us one each week, and that was what we did. And I came in there, and I really liked her, and I was jealous of her. The reason I was jealous was because when she came in to the lesson, she had a message of what God had blessed her with that week. Well, God wasn't blessing me like that. That's why I was jealous. Anyhow, I thought, she's got something really good going. Well, so I called this Shirley. Shirley, guess what? And I told her what I told you. And she said, oh, Avi, that's wonderful, but don't tell anyone. And I said, what? And she said, don't tell anyone. And I said, well, why not? And I don't remember what she said. I've forgotten what she said. Maybe God will reveal it to me the next time I tell the story. But she told me why not to tell. And I don't remember what she said. And I said, well, all right. But she said, don't get me wrong, I'm glad this happened. She said, we in Haiti, where she was the missionary, and she was on horseback, and she was going out into the country, having a little bit of dental education, pulling rotten teeth, and doing emergency dental work, as well as knowing God and talking about Christ and
thank
with
you,
her
Jesus.
Husband. And beautiful. She was home on furlough for a year.
Yes.
And she said, I ran into people that were filled with the Holy Spirit there that were had experiences like yours. In other words, I know now, as God is teaching me from the past, that she didn't have what I had. I think. I'm not sure. But she knew of others who had it and had seen this operating. But she, in her Baptist bag, is sort of what my net doesn't hold is a fish kind of thing, that the Baptists that were supporting her financially didn't like this Holy Spirit business. They weren't into that. In fact, because of the Azusa movement way back in 1901 that swept this country, the other conservative groups wet blanketed and called those people crazy. And so this has been going on. In fact, my mother said, don't go to any Pentecostal churches because they're holy rollers and they're dangerous and crazy. And I didn't remember that until later. Not when I was wanting to know more about the Holy Spirit.
When I arrived there, Dr. Black pressed on my side and he said that intern at Tarpon's made a dreadful mistake. He would have ruined a vacation for two fine families. Your appendix aren't even swollen. Well, what he didn't realize was that they had burst in the ambulance, and so they were not swollen. The swelling had gone down, and I felt better. Another thing, I had never even taken aspirin up to this point, and because of the extreme pain at Tarpon Springs, they had given me a shot of morphine. I'd never had drugs, and so I thought I was cured. Not realizing the pain was there, I was not feeling it. They explained to me that the blood test showed peritonitis, gangrene, but he said, you Yankees get sick up north, and then you come down to Florida in this hot July weather, and you already have infection, and this makes you worse. And this is what's happened to you. He said, we're going to give you antibiotics and you'll be back out on the beach in a couple days. I reached up and hugged Dr. Black. That was what I wanted to hear. We did not have the money for this vacation. We borrowed the money, my family. And we did not have any medical insurance. So, and I had two new swimsuits I charged at Miles Brothers. And when you got two new swimsuits, you don't want scars on your stomach and you want to go to the beach. So I love Dr. Black right off. They put me to bed and gave me something to help me sleep, and he patted my hand. He said, I'll see you in the morning. Well, he saw me in the morning all right about 4 a.m. I woke up screaming, vomiting again. He said, you've been barking up the wrong tree. This woman has a tubular pregnancy in the right tube. About a 4 months dead fetus, and surgery immediately is necessary. We probably waited too long. I will never forget the fear I had. I'd never had surgery, and my parents were confused. Three doctors with three different diagnoses. So they, thinking it was tubular pregnancy. In the recovery room, in the ICU, I heard them talking. The first little intern was right. It was a ruptured appendix 11 days ago, and it was too late. We have found a mass the size of a man's head of gangrene. It has coated all of her organs. They have started to disintegrate. There is a serious bowel block, and if she lives, we will have to do surgery again for the bowel block, and they did. In about 3 days, I believe it was. Then the infection went wild through my whole system. The doctors explained to my husband and didn't know I could hear all of this, that if I lived, they would have to do a colostomy and I would carry a bag on my side for elimination. I was about to get the greatest education of my entire life. I lapsed into a coma that lasted the greater part of 44 days. I had no idea that a person that was unconscious could hear anything, but I heard everything that went on in that room. I was little things we take for granted. It was so wonderful to eat again. But in the room came Sarge. I finally got to meet her. I recognized that voice right away. She said, I have to run this tube up your nose, down your throat, so you don't vomit and hemorrhage. And before she could do that, a lady came in the room, and I listened to learn that she was complaining to the nurse because she was well and was going home in about 10 minutes, but all they gave her for her last meal was 4 ounces of 7-Up on crushed ice. The doctor sent orders, don't even pump her stomach. We have to move fast. If food has passed the duodenal muscle, it will be too late. Get an orderly and bring her down. So an orderly arrived, and as we went out the door, I asked him, I said, would you stop in the little room? I have a natural impulse. And he said, sure. He had no idea the whole situation. And he helped me. I had wobbly legs. When I got in there, all of my plumbing worked in every way, does every day, did again this morning at 6 a.m. Little things that I took for granted that mean so very much. It was wonderful. And the doctor said, this is not possible. But I'll tell you, if it was explainable, it would not be a miracle. I never had the drug withdrawal that they were afraid of. I never had the drug habit that they feared. They wondered if I would have a lot of depression that would be unexplainable. And then they warned me about birth control. He said, I saw your innards, and when you leave here, if you would by some miracle have conception, you may produce a deformed child. He said, I would use birth control. This was all explained to me when I left the hospital. I have to tell you that I doubled my weight in about 4.5 or 5 months. You're looking at the happiest depressed woman you're ever going to meet. Never had a drug withdrawal or a drug habit. I think last year I took 8 aspirin. That's not a bad drug habit. And I had a daughter that was born after I died. And she was perfect in every way. I do have some brain damage, but don't tell my publishers. I fooled a whole bunch of people. It has
moment of need, when the moment of grace is necessary, the bowl is full to be poured out. Now, one of the interesting things that's happening in current times is that we've been experiencing an outpouring of the glory of God in the form of gold dust. Now, we've heard of this happening in a number of countries. When we were in Jackson, Tennessee, we were at a church there called Christ the King. And during the evening service, many people in the church started commenting about having this gold dust on their hand. And we looked on our hands, and we had gold dust on our hands. And my daughter, she had more gold dust than any, and she had it on her hands. And it was like God is filling us with gold clothing. He's knitting his golden nature, his divine nature into us that we might reflect his glory. Now, it's just a sign of the real gold, the divine presence or nature of Christ within us. But boy, it's an interesting and exciting sign. Now, we went over to the Methodist Church, and while we're ministering over at the Methodist Church, the same thing happened, and my daughter Ruth, she just had so much gold dust all over her hands. And we also, a pastor, his name is Nick Pappas, he had a paper where he had actually collected some of this gold dust from one of the women who had been praying, and gold dust was just falling out of her hair. And so he collected some of it in this paper, and there was quite a lot of it that was there. We also heard the testimony of how in Brazil there was a church that was praying. They needed finances to cover the costs of their new building project, and there was an outpouring of gold dust in the church, and they were able to pay for the church building. Now, I don't think that's something that God wants to do all the time or every time. I think it's a special miracle, a special sign perhaps of God saying, my people, you are my bride, and I'm clothing you with gold to show you that I love you. You're made of the same nature that I am. You are the children of God. You've been born of my nature, my divine nature, and I'm just showing you a little bit of my glory. And I just think it's exciting that we live in a day when God will do special miracles.
On a day just like today, miracles happened when Jesus walked the earth, and also now.
Yeah. See, in 2,000 years, things haven't changed. 2,000 years ago, Jesus was doing all kinds of miracles. And today, the miracles that Jesus did then, he still does today. I mean, he said, I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has not changed. One particular miracle that happened...
Can I ask you something? What would you say to someone who said, I see no incidents of this in the scriptures. How can you show me and really say to me that this might not be some hidden enticement from darkness rather than from God?
Well, in Psalm 45, it does talk about our being clothed with raiments of gold. We know that Adam in the garden was clothed with the glory of God. We know that Jesus, after his resurrection, his grave clothes were put aside. He obviously would have been clothed with the glory of God. Whether or not he had other clothes, the Bible doesn't tell us either. But we know that he wasn't walking around naked. And if we're going to be clothed with the glory of God, and it does speak about our garments being interwoven with gold. And at the moment, the garment that we wear is this flesh, I mean, apart from these clothes. So I don't see that as being something that's incompatible with Scripture. Also, we're told that we shall be tried and brought forth as pure gold. I mean, there's many Scriptures that speak about gold. In the book of Revelation, we are counseled of Jesus to buy gold. He says, buy gold of me, buy eye salve, the oil. We're also told to buy a raiment of white. So God wants us to be pure, he wants us to be holy, he wants us to be clothed in his glory. The Bible also tells us that we will be clothed with the glory of the sun and of the moon and of the stars. In 1 Corinthians 15, I think it's around verse 43, it says that there is one resurrection of the sun, another of the moon, another of the stars, so also is the resurrection of the dead. Jesus, it said, he shone with the glory of the sun. We know that in Matthew 13, I think it's around verse 43 also, it says that you shall shine with the glory of the sun in the kingdom of the Father. So, there are these natural elements of the reflection of God's glory that it says that we will shine with his glory. And one of the instruments or elements that reflect his glory that is spoken of in the Bible is gold. So if gold is somehow being put on our hands as a sign that he's wanting to clothe us with his glory, not just with gold, I don't think the actual physical gold is the point. But it's a matter of God saying to us, my children, I do love you, and I want to clothe you with my nature, my divine nature. When we have a look at the...
And especially, as your daughter said, gold with oil in it, and you could feel the oiliness of the gold, she said. There was a feeling of, like, slipperiness or...
Yes, yeah. I was told that it was actually inspected at a university laboratory, and they found that it had, it was in three layers. There was the oil and the gold that was there. And I have to confess, at the time when I felt my hands were very oily. And yet, normally when I just sweat, it doesn't feel oily like that. The gold was, the sparkles of it were quite obvious. I was more intrigued than thrilled because I wasn't expecting it. It wasn't something I was saying, oh Lord, fill my hands with gold dust.
Right.
I mean, I would rather the Lord fill my pockets with gold, you know, and then I can, you know, finance some of the ministry, you know, needs that we have. But the fact that he put some gold dust on my hand was like the Lord saying, my son, I can provide for all of your needs. You don't need to care for the expense costs for this and for that. Look, I can clothe you with gold if I need be. You just follow me, you just walk in me, trust me, and I will provide all of your needs. And, you know, and as I thought about that, I thought, well, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. It's a wonderful privilege that, you know, that you would do this for me.
Cool.
And this has nothing to do with gold, but just with the power of God. One of our students had an appendix operation, and we'd gone to pray for him. And as we were praying for him, I was called by an elderly man, would you come and pray for my father? His father was very old. And when we inquired of him what was his condition was that he had collapsed on his way to the toilet or coming back from the toilet, and his arms and legs had no life in them. They had gone, you know, like someone who had a stroke, only a stroke is normally half of your body. But his arms and his legs were paralyzed. No feeling, no movement. But his body, his trunk, his head was all perfectly okay. And we were asked to pray for him. And as we were talking with him, I said to him, because he was 72 years old, I said to him, do you know Jesus Christ? And he said to me, I haven't been to church for a long time. I said, but do you know Jesus Christ? And we then began to talk about salvation in Christ. And as we talked about salvation in Christ, I said, do you want to receive Christ? And he said, yes. And as we prayed and he asked Christ to come into his life, and there was a few little tears coming down his eyes, because I had said to him, well, you're a fortunate man that you're only half dead. because if you were all dead, you would have been in hell. But because you're only half dead, it means you're half alive, and you still have the chance to repent and believe in Christ. And so he received Christ into his life. And then I said to him, would you like us to pray for you that God will heal you? And he said, yes. And so we laid hands on him and we prayed for him. And do you know what happened? He fell asleep. He fell asleep. You know, and here we are, we're praying for the man to be healed, and he falls asleep. So I wasn't going to wake him up, so we went home. And the next day we came back to the hospital. And when we came through the door, and as soon as he saw us, he put his hands up. To let us know that he had been healed, and he was now being held in the hospital because they wanted to find out how he got healed. Because of course there was no explanation for his illness, and now there was no explanation for this miraculous healing that had taken place. So
what they refer to as remote healing—that's what they call it nowadays in the AMA. Remote healing.
Well, thank God for remote healing, because whatever it was. The man was ill and paralyzed. We prayed for him. He went to sleep. He woke up totally healed. And that was the power of God. And we've seen many such you know, miracles taking place like that.
Yeah.
Hi.
Mommy, come up here with me.
The sound that you're hearing in the background is happy voices in the cabin.
Hey, Will. Well, let's play more.
This is an introduction to a series of visits to strange and interesting things and stories from people that you have never met. And the purpose of this collection of video tour is to help you understand all of the activity that's going on around all of us in the spirit realm, which is quite fascinating. Sometimes there is powerful stuff that comes through from the weaker side of the spirit realm. And sometimes there is power and activity that comes through the stronger side of the spirit realm. And being able to discern the difference between the weaker side of the spirit realm and the stronger side of the spirit realm is the next vista, the next... It's actually the most... One could argue that it's the most important environment or topic of research. I call it the mechanics of the spirit realm. A lot of people don't even acknowledge or focus on the spirit realm. So this is, I'm trying to put this together in a way that's as basic as possible so you can kind of figure out for yourself what's really going on. There's bubbles flying around over here. Someone's blowing bubbles. Can you come in here and blow bubbles?
Okay.
Bum ba dum bum bum. Bum 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 bum. Okay, stand right there and blow bubbles at me.
Okay.
Dun 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 dun.
No, we didn't get enough that time.
Dun, 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 dun. Blow them. See if you can blow them up high. Ooh, there's some. There's one. Dun, dun. Dun, 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 dun. Whoa, there's some good ones. Yay! Zoom, zoom, zoom. Bubbles. Bubbles are almost. Whoa! Here, now come stand a little closer.
Okay.
That's good. Yay. Bubbles are almost like. Whoops!
Where are these
napkins? Yeah, run and get a paper towel.
Bum, bum, bum. Well, the bubble stuff tipped over. And now we have bubble napkins. Okay. Okay, now blow some more bubbles at me.
Okay.
Ooh, that's a good one.
I just put it down there. I gotta get some right here.
No, I think you're gonna have to use the bottle. I think it's soaking in the wood too far. Hey, it worked. He picked up bubbles off the floor.
Yes.
See, bubbles are almost like spirits. Because they drift around and you don't know which way they're going to go. They go with the wind. They go zoom, zoom. Use the bottle. I want to get a whole bunch of good ones. Blow them by the window. This way. That's good.
I only got one!
Sometimes when you want it to work, it doesn't work. Oh, you know what? You have to dip it in deeper now because there's not so much bubbles. You got to hold the bottle and dip it in real deep. Tilt it a little bit. There we go. Dun, dun, dun. Dun, 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 dun. Yay! There we go. See?
You know what I do? I catch a bubble on here, and then I do more.
It's hard to catch bubbles. The bubbles are a little bit sort of like spirits, because you don't know if there's two or three of them traveling together. And you're not really sure exactly how they work. Hi, Lonnie. Good morning.
Hi. Yeah.
Boom, 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 boom. Zoom. And that's our introduction. Thank you very much.
There's baptism in water, and some are leaving out that there's
baptism in the Holy Spirit, and et cetera, et cetera. So to your knowledge, was that man a man who had been baptized at some point in his life?
No.
To
the best of my knowledge, he had not previously been baptized.
Uh-huh.
At least not in the biblical way, by immersion, uh-huh. In obedience to the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
But certainly after that he was. And came to know Christ. I mean, he was a traditional Christian, you know, by statistics, but had never ever given his life to Christ. Mm-hmm. It was this particular physical illness that now brought him to the point of wanting to know what was going to happen to his eternal soul.
Mm-hmm.
The same thing happened with another man that I knew. His wife had prayed for him for more than 30 years. You could say it's the principle of the bowl again. She had prayed for him for over 30 years. Now, his name was Cook Sun. This is lived in Jakarta. And she had prayed and prayed and prayed for his salvation. And he had one of the foulest mouths of a man that I'd ever met in Indonesia, a Chinese man. He was also in his upper 70s. And I came home late at night. I was staying at this home. And his wife was away at a prayer retreat. Now, she's praying. Her husband has a heart attack. And I come into the home and I get called into his room. You know, Cook Sun, he's had a heart attack. Would you come in and pray with him? And I go in there and he's, you know, he's really struggling for breath. And he's the doctor's been called. And I said to him, Cook Sun, don't you think that it's time that you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? He said, oh, yes, yes. Oh, Jesus, forgive me. He got filled with the Holy Ghost and began speaking in other tongues. I didn't talk to him about being filled with the Holy Spirit or speaking in tongues. I just talked to him about knowing Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior, and it was time. Here he was. He was on the edge of eternity. It was time for him to make a decision. But when he asked Christ to come into his life, he was immediately filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking with other tongues. And a couple of hours later, he passed away in my arms. I was nursing him as he passed away and as he entered into eternity. And to me, that was a joy. I had known the man for many years. And here he is. He's received Christ in his life. He's been filled with the Holy Spirit, and he's now gone into out of eternity. His wife comes home. She's upset because her husband's died, of course, and she's mourning because he's gone to hell. She doesn't know that he got saved. And then one of the helpers said, ma'am, no. He asked Jesus to come into his life. He got filled with the Holy Spirit, and he spoke in tongues. And all of a sudden, she just took off, and she started running around the house, jumping up and down for joy. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. I'm going to meet him in heaven. And, you know, her mourning turned into joy and rejoicing. And but certainly, I mean, that particular instance, he didn't have time to get baptized. It's like the thief on the cross. He couldn't very well come off the cross and say, excuse me, crucifiers, would you please let me get baptized because I've just been promised entrance into paradise. But certainly everybody who receives Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, the imperative of Scripture is repent and be baptized. Baptism is not an option, and it doesn't come before repentance. You know, some people think they get baptized, you know, but all they did was get wet or get some water sprinkled on them or splashed on them. But repentance and baptism is really an integral part of the foundation of being a Christian. Repentance is what we experience in the heart when we turn away from sin, we receive Christ by faith, we acknowledge him as our Lord. Water baptism is like signing the contract of eternal life. It's the public testifying to the fact of what I've experienced in my life. And the Apostle Paul said in Romans 6 that we are crucified with Christ in yeah. baptism. We are buried with Christ in baptism. And we are raised with Christ in baptism. And so when we're baptized, it can't just be a sprinkling with water either. It's a funeral service. And I don't know anywhere where there's a funeral service where people are just sprinkled with a little bit of dirt.
That's a good one.
They are buried.
I like that. Thank you. Appreciate that.
And So the dead, they're dead in sin and trespasses. They have to be buried. The old man is buried. We are buried with Christ. And that's what Romans 6 is all about. We are buried with Christ, and then we are raised again to walk in newness of life. Now, of course, when I baptize people, I say to them, if I'm not sure that you've repented, I'm going to hold you under the water a little bit longer. No, not really. The point is, in water baptism, we are identifying with the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. And so, if we want to walk in full obedience to everything that God is saying to us to do, to establish our foundation, maybe we can even take from 1 John chapter 5, verses 7 and 8 there, where it says, there are three that bear witness on the earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And we have these three elements which witness in our lives. We have the witness of the blood through the redemption of Jesus Christ. We have the witness of the water by being baptized in water. And we have the witness of the Spirit because we're baptized with the Holy Spirit. So this is a threefold cord that establishes our Christian life. Now, if a person receives Christ as their Lord and Savior and they die without being water baptized, are they saved? Yes. If they don't get baptized with the Holy Spirit, never speak in tongues, are they saved? Yes, they are. Because we are saved by faith, through repentance of our sins, through believing in Jesus Christ, receiving Him as our Lord and Savior. But if we want to walk in salvation, then we need to be water baptized. It's a matter of obedience. If you love me, Jesus said, obey my commandments. And one of His commandments is, be baptized. Go into all the world and preach the gospel, baptizing them into the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So it's a command that Jesus gave, that we might have the foundation established within our lives. Repentance and faith, water baptism, and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The witness of the blood, the witness of the water, and the witness of the Spirit make a threefold cord that's not easily broken. And when these three foundational cords are in our lives, it gives us a good foundation for growth. And I think that helps us to understand too that people who teach that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is the ultimate experience are missing out on the fact that the baptism in the Holy Spirit is just a basic foundation to help establish us in the faith that we might learn to be more effective witnesses for Christ. So as we live in Christ, follow Christ, and are equipped to serve Christ, that's the start of our Christian experience.
Amen. The experience that I've had from using the scripture, that hit me quite strongly as well, because the implication is that the flood of Noah,
jubilee in the consummation of all ungodly flesh. So I think God's put a wonderful blueprint there, and He's put His signature on it, with the signature of the water, representing the period of the fathers, the signature of the blood, the sacrifice of bulls and goats, which consummated in the sacrifice of Christ, and then the signature of the Spirit, the age of the church age, the age of grace, when the Spirit of God has been moving on the face of the earth to bring mankind into full salvation.
Well done.
Well, the Lord bless you, and trust that this time and this little sharing in the Word of God and testimonies will encourage your faith.
Can I ask one more?
Little Nurse's aide came in and brought a tray and propped me up. Now, when she propped me up, I looked into a mirror on the wall, and I'm 5'12", and I weighed between 68 and 80 pounds, and my hair had not been shampooed for 9 weeks. And I knew then that I had been to an unusual place because I didn't care how I looked anymore. It was so wonderful to have a second chance to live again. And I knew something else, that the only thing you can take with you to the next life is people. And I wanted to invest in people. Suddenly, you have in your hands the ability to enhance and restore life's most precious treasure, the health of human beings. And I would like to close in prayer and ask God to bless you. Father, I thank you for these specialized people that you have called apart. and given great opportunity to help, maybe to build a bridge from this life to the next for eternity, or to give a second chance by restoring life and the vibrancy of health. And I pray that you would supply their financial needs. I ask you to meet their personal needs. I ask you to mend broken hearts and broken marriages represented here today. And I ask you, Lord, to touch them physically, that they may perform at the peak of health and their best capability. And for all of these things that you will do for us, we will thank you. For we have prayed in the name of Jesus, the Son of the living God. Amen.
These are just a few bits and pieces that have been gathered across a period of about 10 years. And if you're interested in the full story or descriptions of any of the things that you've heard or peoples that you've seen, well, offer up a prayer for a thing called Flat Out Miracle Films.